Hello students of Standard 9th. Today we will learn 4.3 Intellectual Rubbish by Bertrand Russell. Bertrand Russell was born on 18th May 1872 at Ravenscroft, Britain. He was a British philosopher, logician, mathematician, historian, writer, social critic, political activist, and a Nobel laureate. In this article, he highlights the vices of the human mind that hamper logical thinking. We begin with the lesson. To avoid the various foolish opinions to which mankind are prone, no superhuman. Superhuman means having exceptional quality or power. Genius is required. A few simple rules will keep you not from all error, but from silly error. Error means mistake. If the matter is one that can be settled by observation, make the observation yourself. Aristotle is an ancient Greek philosopher and scientist, could have avoided the mistake of thinking that women have fewer teeth than men by the simple device of asking Mrs. Aristotle to keep her mouth open while he counted. He did not do so because he thought he knew. Thinking that you know, when in fact you don't, is a fatal mistake, to which we are all prone. I believe myself that hedgehogs are small porcupine-like animal, eat black beetles, because I have been told that they do. But if I were writing a book on the habits of hedgehogs, I should not commit myself until I had seen one enjoying this unappetizing means not tasty diet. Aristotle, however, was less cautious. Many matters, however, are less likely easily brought to the test of experience. If, like most of mankind, you have a passionate conviction means firm beliefs or opinion on many such matters, there are ways in which you can make yourself aware of your own bias. If an opinion contrary means opposite to your own, makes you angry, that is a sign that you are subconsciously aware of having no good reason for thinking as you do. If someone maintains that 2 and 2 are 5, or that Iceland is on the equator, you feel pity rather than anger, unless you know so little of arithmetic or geography that his opinion shakes your own contrary conviction. The most savage controversies are those about matters as to which there is no good evidence either way. So, whenever you find yourself getting angry about a difference of opinion, that means you don't agree, be on your guard. You will probably find an examination that your belief is going beyond what the evidence warrants. A good way of ridding yourself of certain kinds of dogmatism. Dogmatism is insisting of truth of one's opinion, is to become aware of opinions held in social circles different from your own. When I was young, I lived much outside my own country, in France, Germany, Italy, and the United States. I found this very profitable in diminishing the intensity, that means in making less, diminishing is in making less, the intensity of insular prejudice. Insular prejudice means when we are ignorant or uninterested. If you cannot travel, seek out people with whom you disagree and read a newspaper belonging to a party that is not yours. If the people and the newspaper seem mad, perverse is stubbornly opposed to contrary ideas, and wicked, remind yourself that you seem so to them. In this opinion, both parties may be right, but they cannot both be wrong. This reflection should generate a certain caution. Becoming aware of foreign customs, however, does not always have a beneficial effect. In the 17th century, when the Manchos are living in Manchuria, conquered China. It was the custom among the Chinese for the women to have small feet and among the Manchus for the men to wear pigtails. Instead of each dropping their own foolish custom, they each adopted the foolish custom of the other. And the Chinese continued to wear pigtails until they shook off the dominion. Dominion is sovereignty or control of the Manchus in the revolution of 1911. For those who have enough psychological imagination, it is a good plan to imagine an argument with a person having a different bias. This has one advantage and only one as compared with actual conversation with opponent. Now this one advantage is that the method is not subject to the same limitations of time and space. Mahatma Gandhi deplored means he expressed strong condemnation about railways and steamboats and machinery. He would have liked to undo the whole of the Industrial Revolution. You may never have an opportunity of actually meeting anyone who holds this opinion. Because in Western countries, most people take the advantage of modern technique for granted. But if you want to make sure that you are right in agreeing with the prevailing opinion, you will find it a good plan to test the argument that occurred to you by considering what Gandhi might have said in refutation. Refutation is action of proving that a statement or a theory is wrong or false of them. I have sometimes been led actually to change my mind as a result of this kind of imaginary dialogue, and short of this, I have frequently found myself growing less dogmatic. Dogmatic means insisting on truth of one's opinion. And cocksure. Cocksure means confident in excellent, excessive, arrogant way. Through realizing the possible reasonableness of a hypothetical opponent. Hypothetical means based on an assumption. Be very wary. Wary means very careful of opinions that flatter. Flatter is a false praise of your self-esteem. Self-esteem means self-respect. Both men and women, 9 times out of 10, are firmly convinced of the superior excellence of their own sex. There is abundant evidence. Abundant means plenty of signs on both sides. If you are a man, you can point out that most poets and men of science are male. If you are a woman, you can retort. Retort means reply that so are most criminals. The question is inherently insoluble. Inherently means by nature. But self-esteem conceals, that is, hide this from most people. We are all, whatever part of the world we come from, persuaded that our own nation is superior to all others, seeing that each nation has its characteristic merits and demerits. That means good and bad. We adjust our standard of values so as to make out that the merits possessed by the nation are really important ones, while its demerits are comparatively trivial. Trivial means very small or insignificant. Here again, the rational man will admit that the question is one to which there is no demonstrably right answer. It is more difficult to deal with the self-esteem of man as man, because we cannot argue out the matter with some non-human mind. The only way I know of dealing with this general human conceit is to remind ourselves that man is a brief episode in the life of a small planet, in a little corner of the universe, and that for aught, that is anything, we know, other parts of the cosmos may contain beings as superior to ourselves as we are to jellyfish. Other passions besides self-esteem are common source of error. Of these, perhaps the most important is fear. Fear sometimes operates directly by inventing rumors of disaster in wartime, or by imagining objects of terror such as ghosts. Sometimes it operates indirectly by creating belief in something comforting such as excellent that is divine substance that make somebody immortal of life or heaven for ourselves and hell for our enemies. Fear has many forms, fear of death, fear of the dark, fear of the unknown, and that vague generalized fear that comes to those who conceal from themselves their more specific terrors. Until you have admitted your own fears to yourself and have guarded yourself by a difficult effort of will against their myth-making power, you cannot hope to think truly about many matters of great importance, especially those with which religious beliefs are concerned. Fear is the main source of superstition and one of the main source of cruelty. To conquer fear is the beginning of wisdom in the pursuit of truth, as in the endeavor after a worthy manner of life. There are two ways of avoiding fear. One is by persuading ourselves that we are immune from disaster, and the other is by practice of sheer courage. The latter is difficult and to everybody becomes impossible at a certain point. The former has therefore always been more popular. Primitive magic has the purpose of securing safety, either by injuring enemies or by protecting oneself by talisman. Talisman is an object or a ring having magic powers to bring good luck. Or incantation. Incantations are series of words which are used as a magic spell or charm. Without any essential change, belief in such ways of avoiding danger survived throughout the many centuries of civilization. Science has now lessened the belief in magic, but many people place more faith in mascots than they are willing to avow. Neither a man nor a crowd nor a nation can be trusted to act humanely or think sanely under the influence of a great fear. And for this reason, poltrons are cowards who are more prone to cruelty than brave men and are also more prone to superstition. But we have been getting too solemn. Superstitions are not always dark and cruel. Often they add to the gaiety of life. Gaiety of life means the cheerfulness. I received once a communication from the god Osiris giving me his telephone number. He lived at that time in a suburb of Boston. Although I did not enroll myself among his worshippers, his letters gave me pleasure. I have frequently received letters from men announcing themselves as the Messiah. Messiah is God, and urging me not to omit to mention this important fact in my lectures. I admire especially a certain prophetess. Prophetess is a woman who speaks for God, who lived beside a lake in northern New York State about the year 1820. She announced to her numerous followers that she possessed the power of walking on water and that she proposed to do so at 11 o'clock on a certain morning. At the stated time, the faithful assembled in their thousands beside the lake. She spoke to them saying, "Are you all entirely persuaded that I can walk on water?" With one voice they replied, "We are." "In that case," she announced, "there is no need for me to do so." And they all went home much edified. Edified means they learnt a lesson. Perhaps the world would lose some of its interest and variety if such beliefs were wholly replaced by cold science. A wise man will enjoy the goods of which there is a plentiful supply, and of intellectual rubbish he will find an abundant diet, and in our own age as in every other. So students, I know this chapter is little boring, so I will give you a brief summary to understand this lesson better. The title of the chapter, Intellectual Rubbish, refers to unimportant conservative beliefs that many educated people still believe and which has been practiced over centuries and are prevalent even today in the so-called modern lives. So man is said to be the only rational animal in this world. Yet he is driven by some foolish opinion at some point of time in life, and the main reason behind illogical thinking is that most of mankind is obsessed with passionate conviction on many matters, and this is how we become biased towards them, hesitate to change our thinking, and there is nothing but dogmatism. And this chapter highlights the different ways in which we can get rid of this intellectual rubbish, and some of the ways include: observe ourselves when there is contradiction, to our own ideas or beliefs, travel broadens one's mindset and allows us to think more rationally as we come across many types of people. Getting rid of our social circle, which confines or restricts us to certain way of thinking. Seek out people whom you disagree. It is always a pleasant experience to carry out a healthy argument with people whom you disagree, and this will help you to think from their perspective, thereby reducing the intensity of insular prejudice. So whatever prejudice you have, wrong notion, idea, that will be cleared out. So student, for your assignment, you have the warming up on page 93. Then you have the questions at the side on page 94, 96, 97. And you have the English workshop on page 98, 99. Thank you.